Thank you all for joining us at Camera Image. I know that you have lots of things to do, and it's great that you all turned out today to see us talk about Sony products and then the filmmakers that use those products. If we could see the first slide. This is kind of where we're at. From the Sony standpoint, what we've been accomplishing over the last few years is not just one camera, but a family of cameras. It allows you to be able to use different cameras depending on either the need, whether it's either size or budget, or even combining cameras. And that's, I think, one of the things that we are seeing a lot of now is people combining cameras. And through the work of our engineers, they have a lot of commonalities. Next slide, please. It's a bit of an eye chart. But if you look at it, it's really important now, because if you look at cameras, it's not necessarily what is the images and what is the frame rate, but also if you look across it, you can mix and match. So things like time code, those are in all of those cameras. The color science is the same for all of those cameras. So that is, I think, where I'm extremely happy of where we're at, that we've launched a family of cameras that work together that either grow with you as you start out with the less expensive cameras, and then grow up with that line. So it's really a full line of cameras. So that's kind of why we're here today. And to help tell that story, Chris Schmidt, director and cinematographer, Peter Mardson, cinematographer and DIT, former DIT. And Oren Soffer, cinematographer. So we just recently announced a new camera, the Burano, and Chris took it out for a spin, and this is what he came up with. So let's take a look at the first clip.
Man, I want to watch it.
Today is a day to remember. Is it the sun feeling slightly warmer? Is it the unique blend of scents telling stories from the wilderness? Today is a day to remember. Is it your heart beating faster? Is it this vibrant thrill whilst listening to the wild inside? Framed by enchanting woodlands. Noticing the background for an instant. You paint life in myriad hues and shades. Capturing the light in each soul. Like a shining beacon of hope. Wish we could treasure all creatures as if they were the last of their kind. And protect their homes as if they were ours. Eternal, yet so fragile, life cycle unfolds before our eyes. Today is a day to remember. Just like other days, we all have something special. We are alive. they are alive. And it lights up our hearts with radiant hope as we encounter so many extraordinary moments. Life is the most wonderful journey. And we want to remember every moment of it.
That was beautiful, Chris.
Thank you.
How long did the day to remember, the one day to remember, take to shoot?
So it was 12 days on location, which is, it looks long, you know, 12 days, but with wildlife, it's very short. It's very short because, you know, when you're working with animals, you can't act them, you can ask them to do something. So just to give you an example, so, how it works, if, you know, the lions, they sleep 20 hours a day. So what we try is to get the lions very early in the morning at the best light. So in Africa, the best light lasts 1 hour or 1 hour 30. So if you don't get the lions very early in the morning, at dawn or, you know, before it's getting too hot, then they start to sleep. And if you arrive too late, so they're sleeping, and if they're sleeping, you have nothing to do, and it's too late to go to check for leopards, something like this. So it's almost a cross day already. Even, you know, even at 8 o'clock, you can know if your day is going to be good or not. And so that's why 12 days looks long, but it's very short for filming wildlife on location.
In speaking of days, you got a lot of time to prep with the Burano. How much time did you have to prep before you went out?
So I got contacted by Sony, I think it was 10 days before the project. We got an assignment in Zambia, and they contacted me if I was interested to do a short film in Zambia. You know, we know that the days were limited, so that's why we include a human touch inside. So that's the only things we can control when we will be on location. And that's how we start writing the script for the voiceover. And we received the Burano one day before to go to Zambia. So that's why it's a bit challenging, you know, for all the setup, the equipment, the mat box, if we need all the base plate to know if it will be working or not. And I remember also for the music, so I've been working with Christian, which is an amazing composer, and I called him a day before to leave the Zambia. I say, Christian, I have an assignment for you. And I know the deadline is very short, because when we are back from Zambia, we have only 5 days of post-production. So that was very challenging. And I say, okay, that's the script. That's how I want to start the short film. So can you try to start composing the music when I'm in Zambia? Because otherwise it would be too late. So he knows me since a long time, so he knows what I like or doesn't like in music. And I know when I will be on location, I have no internet connection, so I won't be able to exchange with him if it's good or not. And so I received the first drive on the day back home, and he was composing the first 1 minute, and from here we built the shorts. But yeah, the deadline was very short for the project.
Thank you for your trust in us to give you a camera the day before you went out. That's amazing. Can we roll that second clip with no audio? This should be the BTS, right? Yeah. So this is kind of the BTS, Chris. A little bit of of you in the making of the, of a single day over 13 days. What were some of the things that, that kind of struck you as the benefits of the Burano?
So when we are working with the wildlife and natural history stuff, we are always trying to be a small team. So we are two or three persons. So you know, it's very interesting to have a camera which is also easy to operate because you don't have a lot of people with you to help. So the Burano was amazing to test, and I really wanted to test the camera in real condition because it's where you can see the limitation if you have some limitation. So that's why I think it was very interesting to use the camera in a real project and see if it works or not, if it's entering the production. And the first thing which I think was very interesting for me was all the different crop factor, because you know, I love to use different lenses because lenses open up creativity. You know, as creativity, you can use different lenses, different flare, anamorphic, normal lens. So by having different crop factor, you can use the full frame in 8K. You can use 6K downscale from full frame, the 6K at 35. So you can play with different lenses. We were shooting with autofocus lenses as well. The Sony GM, we were using PL mount with stabilization. We were using the CN20 for wildlife shots in F35. So it's, you know, it's all this versatility that you can have in one camera. So that was very interesting. The second thing I think it's the ND filter. I will show you after sequences, but the ND filter is inside the body is an incredible tool for us as a wildlife filmmaker, because if I use the 51,000, when I'm zooming in or putting the converter, I will lose some light, some f-stop. So I can, with the internal ND, I can quickly adjust without, you know, changing a mat box and everything. So that's also a thing that you can earn sometimes. And as I say, with animals, you can't direct them. So it's, you know, each time, and it's funny because sometimes they can feel that when you're changing battery, that's when they start to move. It's always like this. So it's why you need to be very effective. And when we are working like 8 hours in the field, it's 8 hours of concentration. Because as soon as you start to be a bit lazy, that's when things happen. So that's why you need a camera you can rely on. So the ND and also the autofocus, we were using the autofocus with the gimbal shots. So we put just the Burano on a running RS3, and we were using the autofocus of the camera to track the zebra. So you have a trees, I don't know if you remember, passing in foreground, and then you have the zebra in background, and the camera stick on the zebra. It was just amazing, you know. So it's all this combination of autofocus, tracking, open up possibilities by changing the mount, the ND filter, and then the different crop factor. Yeah, that was very useful.
And I think one of the things that we're proud of is the when we introduced the Venice, it booted up really quick, and I can think in your world, boot up time is critical.
Yeah, the boot up time of the camera is, you know, I don't know if someone tried, but it's just 2 or 3 seconds, which is amazing because I was shooting. We discussed together. I was shooting in Brazil last September in the Jaguar. And we were waiting a Jaguar going down from the tree. It took 2 hours to go down. And I was using another camera, and I know that if I turn off the camera, it will take 45 seconds to boot up. And like I say, animals, they can feel. So as soon as we change the battery, the Jaguar will go down. But with a camera that you have a boot up time, which is very fast, 2 seconds, you know, you can just quick turn on the camera, it works. And with big cats, as soon as they start to move, you have some signs. You know, they will start to yawn and everything. So with the Burano, you can turn on and you're ready. But with another camera, 45 seconds, when they start to yawn, it's already too late. They will be gone from the tree. So it's, you know, it's also save a lot of weight because your camera boots quickly, but it saves a lot of batteries as well. And for us, it's very important because we try to limit the number of battery because it's less work as well when you go back to camp in the evening to charge them. If you have 10 batteries or 3 batteries, it's not the same, no, it's not the same evening. And also for the weight. So if we're on location, walking with backpack in the cold and the snow, for example, so everything is in your back, or you know you have a pull car, but it's everything about gaining weight when you're working with natural history. So getting less battery, so it's also, yeah, it's preserving your bike.
Excellent. Can we run the next clip? Can you tell us about this one, Chris?
Yeah, so, you know, it's always funny to speak about autofocus in filmmaking. So here is just a short clip. It was shot with the FX6. And here we use just the autofocus and the auto ND of the camera. So we set up the aperture of the lens, and the camera was fixed on a run-in in front of the car, and we just let the camera work by itself. And for us, it's like a bit of game changing, because this cheetah move, but sometimes you have your run-in too in front with the camera, the FX6 or other, and then you know you're waiting that they move. And sometimes it takes 2 hours, but during 2 hours, the light, it keeps changing and changing and changing. And if you have a matte box in front of your lens, all the time the light is changing, you need to go out because you don't want to disturb. So you're driving out with the car, you need to set to change again the filter and coming back. And you know, during this time, things can happen. So by having the chance to use the internal ND of the camera, you have your application on the phone or the auto ND, and you can, you know, you can just stick next to the cats and do your job. So that's also very interesting.
I think this is another example.
Yeah, that's also another example. And what's very amazed me is even with the grass passing in foreground, the camera stick on the lions on the tree. So it's very interesting for us. You know, it's speaking about, like I say, autofocus in cinema, it's very conservative, so people are a bit afraid. But I think it's, like I say, it's the combination of tracking and autofocus together that change the things, and that's very interesting. Of course, you don't need to use all the time, but at least when you need it, you have the tools in your hand.
Yeah, I think that's the flexibility, the ability to use those tools when you need them, and they make the difference between getting the shot or not getting the shot. So I think it's really great that we've put a lot of tools in there, give you a lot of flexibility, but then you choose it as needed, so it's great. Yeah. I think we have one more clip.
So yeah, it's just a close-up of elephants and then a moving shot of the elephants, but I took the example of the elephants just to show the dynamic range of the Burano, because, you know, elephants, I love elephants, but it's an animal which is quite tricky to shoot because the skin is quite dark. So especially if you are shooting in the evening, backlight, sometimes it's quite tricky to get back the details in the skin, actually. So with the Burano, I was very impressed by how you can recover details in the shadow and the highlight. Even here, you know, it was backlight, so it's a terrible situation for the camera, but I really love to shoot backlight because you have this warmness in the pictures. And in post-production, you are able to recover all the details on the skin of the elephants. So yeah, that's very interesting to see. And I think we have another clip after to show.
Yeah, I never realized elephants had such massive eyelashes. It's pretty impressive. And I think we'll run the last clip. We're speaking of post-production. Let's run the last clip.
So here is just to show the XOCN files and the final results in grading. And what was interesting in Zambia, it's a place with amazing forest. Like you can see, you have dust in the air. And forest, it's, I think you will agree, it's always difficult to render in post-production. So when you're on location, you can see this amazing forest, you're filming, and say, oh my gosh, it's so beautiful, but I don't know if I'm gonna be able to render in post-production. And as soon as we ingest the file and try to play with the XOCN files, I was very amazed because you can recover the details on the trunk of the trees, on the animals inside, but also the light ray. And for me, it was very important to reproduce as well the light rays in the forest with the dust. And you know this feeling that you get in this amazing forest. So playing with the files and the dynamic range was pretty amazing.
Yeah, I think that's when we talked about the commonalities between the cameras, is that's the first camera outside of Venice that records XOCN LT, which we're finding is very beneficial for that. Thank you very much, Chris.
What focal length was that, the cheetah?
So the cheetah was FX6 with the 200-600, the Sony, yeah. So same, you know, the 200-600 is not a fixed aperture. So when you're zooming in and zooming out, having the opportunity to play with the auto ND you know, it's much more easier, so you still have the right exposure in your footage.
Cool. Sorry, I interrupted the applause.
So last week, my colleague Will said, "Hey, Peter's going to join the panel," and he sent me a clip of what we're about to see, which is, it's on our booth, so we've seen it, but I don't think it's ever been seen on a screen this large. But Peter is kind of transitioned to a cinematographer, but still does jobs with people he likes a lot. I think that's probably the best way to say it. But let's take a look at Wingman.
I want to watch this one too.
Thank you.
going to run the BTS really quick so you guys can stay there if you want. We're going to run more clip.
As a filmmaker, we always go into the most unforgiving environments in order to truly demonstrate what the camera can do and what the sensor can do and the color science can do. And I thought, what is one of the most unforgiving environments that I can think of, which was aerial work. This narrative and this story, it was aerial driven. The mounting the camera to whatever craft we were working with is a kind of through line throughout the production. But also we shot that obviously on the Burano and showing that the weight and the ergonomics of the camera, anything heavier than this, I don't think would have been particularly possible. So the Burano's perfect candidate for it, really. We chose the correct time of day to actually showcase what the camera can do. You have to be extremely sensitive to the sun because it can be your best friend or your worst nightmare, as can the atmosphere and cloud cover. One of the things that I personally look for mainly is good dynamic range and controllability of the highlights and the shadows. It's dynamic range is pretty staggering, as it always is with Sony. You've got extreme sunlight, you've got extreme cloud, you've got extreme shade. The main backdrop was the coast that had the sun directly kicking off of the sea. Naturally, within that palette, you've got extreme highlights to extreme shadow. And the camera dealt with it beautifully. We did use the stabilization, which is staggering. It's game-changing, really. If you're going handheld or fast motion, it's extremely sympathetic to the operator. It's a magnificent piece of technology. The resolution is staggering, especially when you see it on a big screen. It kind of takes your breath away a little bit with its sharpness and detail. That enables you to augment that and work with it. The clarity of the image is a real tool for the cinematographer to work with. To my eye, really, if I deep dived into the entire thing, I could tell you exactly which shot was shot on Venice or Burano, but actually, when you look at the picture as a complete series of images, you can't. And that's what was the most impressive sort of point for me, is the fact that you can utilize this camera within a family of cameras. That was fantastic. The variable ND in this camera is absolutely incredible. I would set the stop on the ground with my meter. We would send it off in the air, and it would go through the most insane lighting range as far as extreme exposure and extreme shadows, and then would land, and then we would review the footage, but never at any time did it either clip or did it go below the knee. I'm a believer of the CineAlta range, especially the Venice and the Venice 2, and this is a no exception, really. You can utilize this camera, it's got its strengths, and the Venice has got its strengths, and the Rialto system has also got its strengths. The ecosystem just completely blended perfectly. It's a beautiful, complementary member of the CineAlta family.
I have to confess, when I first saw that, I went to James's IMDb to see, like, what, did I miss something? Because I was blown away by what you guys did with that. So thank you very much. That is beautiful. What were some of the bigger challenges in making that?
The biggest challenge was camera mounting onto an airframe. And you may have heard in there, it's not exclusively Burano. So the idea was that it was going to be Burano for everything. Then you present it to the pilot and the company and say, well, we want to put this on there, but unfortunately it's a little bit too heavy. So, of course, then we look at the alternatives, but the alternative, of course, is a Rialto, and it worked perfectly because the main concerns with that sort of aircraft, because it's very agile for doing stunt work and pulling lots of Gs, and is that you need perfect center of gravity, you need perfect aerodynamics, and you can see the camera's mounted on the wing, and it's actually got mounting points for cameras on this particular aircraft, so we're very much restricted, so we couldn't alter anything without getting new approvals, and you know, so there was obviously that sort of more like paperwork, really. So effectively, right, well, anything that's on the aircraft is Rialto, everything else is Burano, and that was a decision that had to be made. And it sort of turned our test in from just testing a Burano, but actually testing it alongside the other Sony cameras. In obviously, this is a Venice 2 with the Rialto. And as James says, yeah, it's they're seamless. Like, I was getting footage from, we were running two Rialtos on that plane. So we would have two running at the same time. And on the ground, we'd have the other two Buranos on long lens doing the takeoffs and landings, and obviously in the chopper as well. And I'd be getting all the mags in and then put it into the Resolve project. And I go, well, it looks the same to me. So it was actually a fantastic test for that reason, because often when you're doing sort of the scale of pictures that I end up doing, which is usually large motion pictures, and doing a second unit, you end up with all sorts of camera rigs. So the fact that we could just put this in and it's seamless was amazing. That was the challenge. But you know, every camera's got its pros and cons. And when you know, a Rialto is still quite an amazing little product because it's just so compact. So for example, where it's we're looking straight at the pilot, that's the only way we could do it. We actually tried to put a Burano in there, but you know, then it's compromising on your lens and your field of view. So get the camera as far back as possible inside the canopy. And then there was actually another one on the opposite side to get the propeller shot, as you can see. So it's really compact. And, you know, for these sort of stunt sequences, it's almost like a no-brainer in a way, because it's just so much more, you can just do that. And then for... there's going to be like the car rig, for example. The car rig is a perfect example of, you know, putting a Burano on, because in a way the Venice body by itself there is actually a bit too long. There's going to be little moments where you're just going to just mix and match. And you know, if you're doing a second unit on a film, yeah, it's perfect, because then you know, you have a couple of those and a couple of Buranos and a couple of Venice with the Rialto kits, and mix and match a bit. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's, again, that flexibility of knowing the different tools and bring them to bear when you need to.
It's just, it's another important part of the toolkit now, yeah.
And then how did you order up those amazing clouds and all of that, which is just beautiful and stunning?
Well, it's Britain, and the weather changes every hour. Normally, in my job as a DIT for a long time as well, is that I've usually got the weather forecast and the radar up on my setup. Even when I'm just, you know, we're in a forest or something like that, and you want to know when the weather's coming and when the clouds are coming over. But of course, in this case, we're actually in an airfield about 10 miles away, but still looking at the radar and just going, well, it's completely cloudy here. So this is how we set the stop, for example, on the airframe, because that. By the time we had a transmission on it, but we got probably about halfway to the coast on the transmission just to make sure it was working, and then it disappeared. So it's effectively setting a stop on sort of going, well, the radar says that's what the clouds look like over there, whereas it's completely overcast where we are. So that's, and then the rest of the shots where, you know, obviously seeing the aircraft doing that, that's all on helicopter, and that's that was just James sitting in the cockpit, exposing straight off the monitor. Nothing fancy there. We just set the monitor up, made sure it actually looked good. Yeah, he did a really good job. So I didn't have any problems there. In terms of the grade, like, the, for example, that sunset shot looks amazingly artificial, I guess, these days, but that is what came out of the box. You know, and there's no volume work in that, by the way. That pilot, he looks, there's obviously a lot of footage that we shot, which you haven't seen, but that pilot looks like he's going shopping in some of the G-forces, because he's just, like, just casual. So it's quite incredible, actually, what the footage we got from it, that you know, that's left on the cutting room floor, but yeah.
I think you mentioned that there was another production going on that maybe was aware of you guys.
Yeah, exactly. So that actually made it even more real, because we were filming over 2 days, and there was another production on the beach, and they finally contacted us on the second day, so could you stop buzzing us?
Again, I think you've worked with a lot of Sony cameras. You've kind of run the gamut throughout the years, and I think we're at a place now that's really remarkable to be able to do that. But what are some of the things, I think, from the evolution of the cameras that you've seen that most stand out to you?
Well, I've always found them quite reliable, and I was speaking to Chris earlier about documentaries, and I've never really got involved, but I worked in rental houses when, we'd have documentaries go away, and they'd come back, and, you know, the first thing I'd do is open the side of the Digibeta and just dirt just pouring out of it. And I'd probably just clean the dirt off and obviously make sure it was all working pretty well and send it back out, and it was pretty rock solid. And that's usually been the main thing with the Sony, the range of cameras anyway. And they're very solid bodies, even when you're just physically touching it and rigging it. And so, you know, there's never been any complaints about that from grips, especially when we're doing rigs on films. So they're very durable and very good images too. So like I say, like, you know, mixing and matching a Burano and the Rialto system on this, yeah, it's just pretty seamless. Like, I actually really couldn't tell the difference alongside each other. So yeah, that was very positive because, you know, especially when you've got a test camera, you know, and I've done lots of test cameras and beta cameras, and, you know, you always go, well, I'm going to look for something, I'm going to look for a problem, and obviously feed it back to whoever I'm doing this for. And in terms of image, yeah, it's great, worked out of the box. That's all I need. And I think, you know, we were very happy with it. You know, like, if I'm clipping the sun, well, great. You know, that's probably what I expect, you know, and that's what I get on the other cameras. So that's pretty much all I need, you know.
And then we did mention that there was no virtual production in the making of the actual movie, but in the interview, if we could see the next slide. It actually was virtual production.
Yeah.
This was done at our DMPCE, our Digital Media Production Center in London, and it's in front of our CLED series wall, which is, you know, we kind of talked about the idea that it looked amazing, so they just took that one step further and put those images up on the wall, and that became the backplate for the interview. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Peter. We're going to try to get through this and we get to you guys' questions. So now we run the next clip.
Yes, also for Peter.
Yeah, oh, sorry. We'll run the next clip.
Is this the... Oh, yeah, so this is a clip we cut for this presentation. So the film's still in theaters, so ignore the words. shuffle back in.
Yeah. So first, welcome to Camera Image.
Thanks.
It's been a bit of a roller coaster, but I'm so glad that you are here. It's a lot of fun to have you here.
Yeah.
The first question that may people like to know is, what camera was that shot on?
Yeah. Well, according to the internet,
is always right.
It was shot on the Alexa 65 and the Sony Venice, and but no, the film was shot on the FX3, Sony FX3.
In when we first, when Gareth and Greg first came and we did a little, like, oh, we're gonna see the FX3, wanna see it, okay. And I thought it might be used for part of it, but yeah. Tell us a little bit about how it all came to be and why Gareth made that decision.
Yeah, I mean, I sort of had the same reaction. Like I got called by Greg to come on and sort of join the project and be boots on the ground because he wasn't gonna be able to be on set because of some indie movie. I don't even know what he was shooting, but something in the desert, I don't know. They told me, that was part of the first phone call. He was like, oh yeah, and we're shooting on the FX3. And I was like, really? That's okay. I didn't even know much about it. I was like, okay, well, I guess you guys know what you're doing. Let's see what it can do, because they already knew. And then it just took one visit to Photochem, and I saw some of the test footage. And Greg had shot a few commercials on the FX3 with the lens, too, and with the Atlas lens that we had as a sort of test run earlier in that year. So I was able to go in and see the footage, and it's so funny because it's like, that was it. That was the end of the conversation. Is you see the footage, you see what it's capable of, and you go, okay, I get it. That's all I need to know. We're just gonna make the movie now. The reason really was Gareth wanted to make this film in a very specific way. And he wanted to imbue it with a very specific feeling and a very specific experience for the audience. He wanted to create a very specific experience for the audience that was incredibly immersive and grounded and felt present and felt like the audience was there in this world that we're creating and was experiencing the story with the characters in a way that felt very immediate. And this was all inspired by his first film, Monsters, which he also shot on a Sony camera. It was the EX3, I think, or the EX1, which is, for people who are old like me, everybody younger than me and Zach over here, wherever he is, won't remember this camera, but it was like an ENG documentary camera. Yeah. It did have an interchangeable lens, but it was like a Micro Four Third sensor, I think. It was a little tiny sensor. And in order to make it look like cinema, you had to put this chunky adapter on the front, the lettuce adapter, and then you could put a lens on that, and then you could pull focus on the lens, and it forced it to look like shallow depth of field. So these were like the crazy things people were getting up to around like 2010 to make movies look like cinema, like scrappy indie films look like that. And then the 5D came out, and everyone was like, ah, great, here we go. Now we don't need all this stuff. So that was really the inspiration. And he shot on that camera, well, first off, because they made that movie for $300,000. And it was made true guerrilla style, no studio, no permits, no, like Werner Herzog would have been very proud of how they made that movie, like driving around in Central America with a script and a vision, but no plan really, like no locations, and like hopping out of the van and you see some really beautiful gully and you're like, oh, this looks great, let's just start filming here. And then if somebody shows up, we'll pay them $50 and make them go away. Like that's how he filmed, that's how he made his first movie. And it was with a tiny crew, 7 people, and then the cast, which were 2 people. And the cast were like lugging sandbags and, you know, well, I don't think they had sandbags. They were lugging whatever, their picnic for the day. I don't know what they are. And they didn't shoot with lights. I mean, it was completely guerrilla style. But if people have seen Monsters, that film feels, it has this very unique feeling where it's cinematic, but it's shot like a documentary in its spirit. And it makes the world feel really grounded, and it puts you, the audience, in the experience of the characters. And so then Gareth did all these visual effects on top of the footage, which he did by himself on a laptop in his bedroom, as he likes to say, which is accurate. And it exploded the scope of the world, like of that tiny little scrappy film. It was able to look and feel like this big epic world. And so the idea for this movie was, we want to do that, but on a bigger scale, on an even bigger scale. And so what are the tools that can allow us to film a movie in that way? Like, what is the 2021, 2022 version of the EX1 that is assumedly much smaller now? You know, we don't have to deal with that kind of size of camera, but that gives you the same flexibility. And it gives you the freedom, and it gives you the ability to shoot like a documentary, but have it feel like cinema. So what gives you that? What allows you to shoot on location instead of on stage and on sets and with big green screens? Like, what gives us the flexibility? And yeah, they found the FX3. I mean, because the thing is you needed a camera that could still deliver images at a quality that could be projected in a theater, and that were robust enough for Industrial Light and Magic for all the visual effects that they needed to do. So it was a very narrow band. It was like, what's a camera that weighs as little as possible, is as physically tiny as possible, but can give you like cinema quality images at 4K that sets us up for post and sets us up for color grading and doesn't screw us over. And it was the FX3. That was that band.
Was ILM's reaction to the shooting, you shooting this on the FX3, similar to yours, or was it a little more?
I think it was probably more extreme than my reaction. I think they were probably like, what are you thinking? And on a vintage anamorphic lens too, which they always hate that stuff. They're like, oh God, here we go.
Very pleased.
Yeah, here we go. Now, but the thing is, they already knew they could do it because Gareth shot a proof of concept film years prior that was part of the pitch to the studios. And he shot that on an even scrappier camera. It was the Nikon Z6 DSLR, I think, Z6, on a little Ronin gimbal, a little lollipop gimbal, with the same lens, the Kowa 75mm. And he shot that by himself. That was pure, that was like Monsters. It was him and Jim Spencer, his producer, who produced The Creator and also produced Monsters. So he brought someone he knew wouldn't freak out about this whole situation, which is crucial. And so they traveled around for 4 months. They were location scouting all over Southeast Asia, Nepal, Cambodia, Thailand, Japan. And they brought that footage to ILM and said, hey, here's what we're doing. This is how we want to make this movie. And we want to add the sci-fi and the world building on top of the footage. And here's this Nikon DSLR footage that assumedly was like, I have no idea what format those cameras shoot, but it was whatever internal format. They were not doing anything fancy. And again, with the anamorphic lens wide open, all this stuff that VFX people hate. And they did it. They did it. They put the sci-fi on top of it. They added visual effects, and it looked amazing. And so they knew that they could do it. And I think that they needed that proof of concept as much as Gareth did and the studios did to know that they can do this. And there's shots from that footage in the movie. There's shots from that footage in this reel.
Wow.
Yeah. So this reel had FX3, but it also had Nikon, and it also had the Mavic drone footage. And then we had to use the FX9 on the volume. There's some
for the gen lock.
Yeah, for the FX3 doesn't gen lock to the walls. So the FX3, look, obviously, I mean, we talked about it. There's a lot of limitations with the camera, and we used it in a way that it's not designed to be used in that way. But I think knowing the limitations just allowed us to focus on what it could do and what we needed it to do. And so that was the kind of pathway forward. It was like, can't do slow-mo, or it's very limited in slow-mo. It's like, okay, well, we don't need slow-mo in this movie. It's not that kind of movie. Time code sync was a whole thing to figure out, but we figured it out because we had to do it across multiple cameras, and we had the Ninja recorder to record ProRes RAW. So that needed time code, and it needed to sync with the camera. By the way, I don't know how this stuff was solved. I just pushed the button. I didn't even push the button. I asked someone to push the button to push record. But our camera team and our DIT, which was a completely local Thai local team, they figured it out with your guys' help. We coordinated, so that was great. And there's certain things it can't do. I mean, it's a limited. It doesn't have internal NDs like the beautiful cameras that you guys had to use. So we had to put a variable ND on the front of the lens and put a tilt and nucleus gear on it, and then I was sat at the monitor adjusting the ND on a little handset as it like adjusting iris. So that was my job. And and that was it, really. That was my only job on set. Yeah, so it was cool. It was a fun process to figure it out. And I think everybody had the initial reaction. Like, even the actors, I think, they showed up on set and they saw the tiny little camera. And they're like, oh, that's the camera? Okay, cool. And then actually, they forget about it because it's so small that you just don't even know. You don't have this big thing, like, in your face. So I think it actually helped them.
Helped the performance.
Yeah, because they were. It was more believable. It was more immersive in the scene. Like, the thing was so unintrusive that you half the time you didn't even know it was there. Sometimes it wasn't there. They were just acting, and nobody. we weren't filming it. No, I'm kidding.
You were just in character.
We didn't do that. We didn't.
And we actually had the ability to jam sync time code, but we waited until you got done, and then we added it after.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, we waited.
For that.
Are you guys done?
Yeah. Okay, now we'll add the feature. Yeah,
we'll
exactly.
Release it. We'll add that now.
Yeah, that's right.
How many cameras did you guys use?
Eight FX3s. And I wish I should have sent you guys some of the photos we could show, but I have a photo of like a basket with all eight of the camera bodies. They're just kind of sitting there like little, they're like little puppies like waiting to be adopted in the, but it was great. I mean, so that was actually part of the filmmaking approach. So the small footprint, the documentary style, the flexibility, the all that stuff was important. But another aspect of the film was we don't love Gareth hates wasting time on set. Like, just does not like. I mean, it's like we flew halfway across the world. We have these actors in costumes and extras and special effects and all this stuff going off, and it's like every minute you're not filming feels like torture, or you're just sitting there. You're like, why aren't we filming? Why aren't we getting footage? And so part of the advantage of having this small camera system was we had eight of them, and we only ever shot one at a time. And sometimes we shot a second camera, rarely. It was maybe 10 days. We had a B camera, which I operated, and. We were able to basically have each camera pre-set up in different rigs. So we had one, our main rig was in a Ronin gimbal custom rig that we kind of tricked out. And then we had one that lived on just a little Ronin gimbal, and that sat on the dolly, which was not a big dolly, it was a Kessler slider. And then we had another twin of that one that sat on our scissor crane, which was not a big techno crane. It was like all this stuff you can buy on B&H. It was ridiculous. And then we had one that was full handheld, no gimbal. And then we had one that you could just pick up in your hand and shoot. Like, there's just had a side handle. And then we had one that lived on a drone. And all these were built at the same time. And they just lived on the table like a buffet of cameras. And so what we could do, and it was kind of brilliant, because you could set up a shot. You could be like, okay, set up the little dolly here. We'll do a push-in. That takes 10 minutes. Okay, I'm going to grab the handheld gimbal. We're going to shoot something else in the meantime. And you can just shoot something quick, like some little stolen moment or some little real interaction that was happening on set with a lot of real people in real villages and real locations, and we wanted that feeling, like we wanted it to feel like an authentic place. So that allowed us to do that. And you could send up the drone and get a quick aerial shot while that's happening, set up the crane, and so it's ready to go. We land the drone, we can do the crane shot while they swap batteries, and then send the drone back up. It was great. It was very flexible. And that little system was the key that kind of unlocked that. Because you're not gonna have eight Venices lying around.
Not on this film. It would be a really nice buffet if you had eight Venices.
Eight Venices? Yeah. Yeah, but you'd need like a long table, like a medieval banquet, and then
yeah, that'd
have
be okay.
The eight. We had a little
we liked that.
We just had a little papa table. They had to fit on this. So
and Gareth operated a little bit.
He operated a little. He operated the whole movie.
Yeah.
He operated every shot. He operated every shot of the movie except the ones that I did. But I was just doing the B camera, the additional angles sometimes. But that was part of it. That was really the whole thing. Was that it was the documentary style, the spontaneity, the freedom, the flexibility of it was because he was operating. And it was because, and again, he shot Monsters and operated the camera on Monsters. He operated the camera on Rogue One. That's his conduit to the scene, is through the camera. Like, he's not, he's just a hands-on director in that way. He doesn't want to sit back and just watch a scene unfold and then have a crew capture it. Because it's like you're removed from the actors, and you're removed from the filmmaking. Like, you're 1 degree removed from it. So then you shoot a scene, and maybe the move doesn't happen exactly the way you pictured it. And then you cut, and then you go in, and you give a note to the operator. Well, no, okay, this time do the move like this. And this just cut all of that out. Like, he has spontaneous ideas that he gets. He has, he's reacting to things that are happening in real time, real people, real places, like I mentioned. And he just needed the ability to react to that stuff himself without it being somebody else. And that's how you get that's where that style comes from, is from that reaction. And then I had to learn that. Like, I had to learn that style so that when I was shooting, I could do the same thing.
Was that hard?
No. Yes, it was hard.
No, it was super easy.
Yeah. No, it's just time. It just takes time. But we had time. That's one thing we had. We had time. We didn't have 2 days, and we didn't have 12 days. We had 90 days, so and 4 months prep. So it was different. That was the, how do we get the best of both worlds? Like, how do we get the filmmaking, the immediacy, the scrappiness, the spontaneity of monsters, but on a bigger scale, with a bigger budget, with support and with everything? Like, how do we meld? We take all the good parts of the flexibility, the freedom, the nimbleness of indie filmmaking, and we get the support and the budget and the tools and the resources of larger budget filmmaking, but without the downside, without having to have a huge camera team that had to move big camera rigs and big rigging and dollies and cranes and big on movie sets. Like, when you build out a camera like the Venice or the Burano, even, they get big. Like, they get really, there's a lot of accessories, a lot of stuff that gets added on. And I think that the little small camera body just forced everyone's hand. It was like, we can't build this out. Like, you have to be able to work with, we had a little Teradek and we had a little Tilta Nucleus for focus pulling and ND pulling. We didn't want to trick it out too much, because then you lose the thing. And also, you can't balance it on the gimbal. You know, you're limited by all these things, but the limitations fostered the filmmaking approach. Like, it one thing led into the other. And it allowed us to shoot the way that we did.
And I think that discussion that you've mentioned before about the team, everybody just moving together and getting behind the vision and executing it, which anyone in that link, if they're not behind it, probably doesn't work.
Yeah. And full credit to the Thai team, the camera team, the grip team, the electrics, because they had no choice, but they all really got it. They got into it. They understood what we needed and what we were doing. The camera team, especially in our DIT Cho, like, they had never worked with the FX3 because nobody really had in this capacity. And so they had to learn. You know, they had to learn, and they did. They learned. They put in the time. They researched. They had a lot of time with the camera. Again, we had 4 months prep, so this wasn't. They didn't get it the day before, and they were. So it was different. And I think if it was this last minute thing, sadly, I mean, it's not sadly, but I've had some people reach out and they're like, yeah, I'm doing this thing next week and they want us to shoot FX3. And I'm like, okay, as long as you have the time to figure it out, because it's not a camera that you can, it's not designed the way that these cameras are to take out of the box, put a lens on it, turn it on and roll. You have to figure out how to work it into the workflow in narrative. And at least in larger budget narrative, and you have to figure out how it fits in the workflow. But if you have the time to do it, then it unlocked this whole other world of filmmaking. So it was really rewarding, and it was great that the team really stepped up to it, and they never panicked. Not the camera team, at least. The key grip had a panic moment, but that was not unrelated to the camera. It was just the speed and the pace of the movement because of the multiple rigs. It was like, set up the crane, and now set up this dolly over here, and da da da. And he was like, I'm one person. How am I going to do that? I don't have 10 arms, but we got him a few extra guys, and it was fine. This is, again, the benefit of having a slightly larger budget is like, oh, we can fix that. We'll get you some extra help. That's fine. We wanted to keep the crew small, but we made it a tiny bit too small at the beginning, the first couple days.
You adjusted.
In the grip department, and we expanded. But the camera team, I have to give him so much credit. A was the name of the focus puller. And he never panicked. somehow. Maybe at least he didn't show it. Maybe he could have been
maybe panicked inside.
He could have been screaming internally, and we just had no idea. He could have been going home to his family and just being like, "What have I done?
What have I done?"
But we never know. We never knew. He always showed up with a smile on set.
And I think ISO. Did you guys play with?
Oh yes.
ISO.
Oh, I'm glad you brought that up because the ISO is also a big component of the filmmaking approach. So the FX3 has two base ISOs. And it has, much like the other Sony cameras, so it has 640, and then it has 12,800 is the second base. And we shot most of the movie at 12,800, pretty much everything except day exteriors, where you're just fighting it so much that there's no point. Just go down to 640 and call it a day. And we're still stacking ND on 640 ISO, as I'm sure anyone who's shot outside, even with like any other camera, Alexa or the other Venices, like 800 ISO is still too much for bright daylight. You have to ND it or stop down to T22, but who wants to do that? That's no fun. But yeah, so 12,800 unlocked this whole other lighting world for us because suddenly, like, you don't need that much light. In fact, it's you have to take light away most of the time. And we wanted to shoot in, again, it's all on location pretty much except for 3 weeks in Pinewood, London. We did 1 week on the volume with the FX9. And then 2 weeks on sort of traditional stage shooting. We did a few stage days in Thailand, I think it was 5 or 6. On location, we wanted to shoot with available light as much as possible. And if not available light, then it was lighting that we were building to look like available light, to feel. It was very practical driven, very organic, very built into the sets, very minimalistic. And just like the camera, we wanted the speed and the flexibility. We didn't want to show up to a location and say, "All right, well, we need an hour to light this space." That's no good. We don't want it to take an hour, or we need to make a quick adjustment between takes. We need to bring in another light. So instead of having to set up a big HMI or something that takes minutes to run cable, it was all battery powered LEDs, apertures, and yeah, Astera tubes, that kind of thing. And so it just meant like you need to add a light, okay. You know, best electric is like turning it on in the background while the take's going, and then we have 30 seconds of a reset. Sneak the light in and keep shooting. And we could do that because at 12,800 ISO, you don't need a lot of light. So some of the night exteriors that you saw in the clip, those are lit with aperture 1200Ds. Dimmed down to 10%, they were too bright. And they were on lifts, the same way that you would do a night exterior, but instead of putting big HMIs or like Dino lights or big tungsten heads, mole phase or whatever, it was which also require a lot of power. The 1200D runs off of a little putt-putt generator or wall power, but obviously we were in the middle of a field, so that wasn't going to work. So that's all you needed. It was just very, it just allowed us to be so minimal and so quick and reactive to what was happening on set, what Gareth was doing with the camera. It was all very spontaneous.
I think you inspired a lot of people to explore tools, right? Let's look at tools and understand what those cameras are capable of. Some of the funny, some of the things that I saw posted that I thought was funny outside of it was shot on some other camera was, I own an FX3. Mine doesn't look like that, which I thought was, well, yeah.
Exactly. So yeah, all you got to do is you take your FX3 and then add $80 million Industrial Light and Magic, Weta Workshop costumes, John David Washington, and then it'll look like that, you know? And a $30,000 lens. The Koas are not, those aren't scrappy lenses. Like, those are this is a serious piece of glass. So it's funny, I know. But the point is exactly what you said, is ultimately it's about rethinking the approach to filmmaking. And so it's not about, oh, this tool will allow you to do X and Y specifically. It's more about like the mindset. What do we need? What do we need to accomplish? How do we want to make this film? And then it's like, okay, what tools? Like, let's think outside the box and not feel limited by convention of, well, this is how it's done. So, you know, you want to make a movie like that, too bad, or do something else. It's like, no, we want to find a way to make it work with and find the tools that allow that. And you just have to Yeah, and you just sometimes have to think outside of the conventional approach. And like I said, this extended to grip and extended to electric. And it extended to every department, but focusing on the camera department or the cinematography, Yeah, it was really about that. And it was, Gareth and Greg, I think, had been having these conversations since Rogue One, just frustration with the inefficiencies of that kind of filmmaking. And obviously there's a lot of benefits for that kind of filmmaking, and that's what we wanted to, take the benefits and do away with the inefficiencies. But sometimes, you know, you say like, oh, we want to go shoot at this location, and you need a helicopter to get there. And it's like, oh, okay, well, that's going to cost X amount of dollars. You need to fly the equipment up there. You need to land a techno crane. You need to, and people do that. But, you know, if you do that for one shot, it's kind of like, why? We just walk up there. If we just had a camera that we can just carry in our hand, we could just walk up there. We don't need all this stuff. Or you're shooting a scene between, there's a lot of big stuff in this movie, but there's also a lot of small stuff in this movie. There's scenes where it's just two characters talking to each other. And you're like, why do we need all the machinery of filmmaking when all you really need, that's the stuff that you can, if you have an FX3 at home, you can get your stuff to look like that. Two characters talking to each other with, you know, learn lighting, learn, understand light. You can do it with your FX3 at home. The rigs have been fun, though. I like seeing the rigs that people build. They try to build the gimbal rig. But it was very custom built. It was not, it took months to figure it out. So it's like, good luck. and honestly, we did a very bad job of like documenting what is in the rig. So I don't even know. Like there's some parts that I have no idea. Like, oh, the Elbra, I don't know what that was. Or the side handles, and like I wish we should have done a better job. But I mean, there's photos, and we have a list of the gear, so we could piece it together. But I'm too lazy.
There's a receipt somewhere.
There is, but I'm too lazy to do it. But the filmmaking approach thing is the big one, and I think the other thing that I've encountered is some people reach out and they're like, oh, we want to shoot in the FX3 because you did it, and we heard that you save money. And it's like, that's the wrong reason.
Yeah.
That's not why we did it. And if you want to shoot something conventional, quote unquote, but use unconventional equipment, that might not be the right tool. There's other tools. Burano might be a better choice because it's all built in. You don't have to figure out a variable ND on the front with a 3D printed lens gear to put a nucleus tilt on. You just use the internal ND. It's like, why are you doing this to yourself? You know, there's other tools. But I think it's just about the mentality. It's about questioning the conventions that are there for a reason. You know, conventions are there for a reason. It's because something that's worked before will work again. Sometimes you have to take a risk. You know, sometimes you have to take a risk. And it was risky.
And I think it paid off. I think it's...
Yeah, it did, but it might not have. It might have not worked.
And it's screening, you're screening tomorrow.
Yeah, tomorrow.
Tomorrow night. So if you haven't seen it yet, it's screening tomorrow.
If you haven't seen it, we're screening tomorrow at 7.
In Friday?
I think just maybe. Just tomorrow, though. Okay. But the movie's still in theaters in some places, so there might still be a chance.
Still a chance.
Yeah, still a chance. But it comes out on VOD and home video today.
Oh.
So
what a great plug.
Perfect timing. So if you want to buy the film, digital version of the movie.
Exactly.
And eventually it'll stream somewhere next month. I don't know exactly when, but eventually it'll be on stream. If you can wait a month, you don't have to buy it.
Don't say that.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Buy it.
Right
buy
now.
It.
All right, now we have to make our $80 million.
Buy the film. Buy the film.
We bought all those FX3s. Sony didn't give.
Someone's got
to
pay for them.
Someone's got to pay for those.
By the way, we sold them.
Nice.
So, from a producing standpoint, it was genius because we bought all of our lights, all of our grip gear, and our camera gear, and then we shot the film, and then they sold all of it.
Should have signed them. They could have been custom.
They could have.
Custom.
You know, could have made it. They could have made extra money.
Extra money.
I bought one of them.
Nice.
They gave me a discount.
I would hope. I think we'll open up to some questions now.
Can we get the lights up on the lights? Could,
yeah.
Lights up on the audience.
Yeah. It's tough to see you. And I think we have a mic. But are you? If you? Oh, there we go. You have the mic. You have the power. Go.
Hello.
There's a movie. There's a movie starting or something. Everyone's going.
I have a question for Peter, because of the propels. Did you guys have any problems with the rolling shutter?
No. We didn't even think about it. And I've been told that the rolling shutter is probably slightly inferior to the bigger Big Brother Venice, but no issue. And I didn't even when we put it on, it was leave it on 172.8. We just looked at the pictures and went, great, send it up. But, you know, like, usually if you look at anything where you have an issue like that, it's usually because someone's tried to fiddle with the shutter, from my experience. So keep it all straightforward and simple, yeah.
Hi, I also have a question for Peter. How did you control the electronic ND when you were in the sky?
We didn't.
I don't.
So it was sort of set at when the stuff that's in the sky with the Burano was actually in the helicopter mount, so there was no control on the ND.
Okay.
So and anything on the ground was actually controlled. So that was actually a bit more straightforward. You know, and you know, we're talking about a camera which is just hasn't even been released. So yeah, I'm sure there's something coming where we can probably do that. But we didn't do anything special in the sky. It was just we set an ND, which because it's variable, I can't even remember exactly where we put it. But you know, we just did it as we would normally shoot. Really, yeah.
But Peter, you looked at the weather report and then set the ND, if I remember.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that's what, you know, and I guess that's just experience from all of us, you know, when, you know, we're going to send it up and we know that, well, he's going to go through the clouds or, you know, what layer of the cloud it is, you know, because, you know, some of these weather forecasts are quite advanced now where they actually tell you where the cloud levels are. So, and then finding out from the pilot how far he's going up, really. You know, if he's going all the way up and it's blue sky, then yeah, then we've got a problem. So it's sort of preparing yourself, you know, getting as much information as possible.
Got it. We have a question here. Where's the microphone? Oh, yeah, there we go.
Hi, guys. Thanks so much for a fascinating talk. I've got a question for Aaron. Sorry to kind of veer off the Sony topic, but Aaron, could you talk a little bit about lenses? I checked on IMDb. There seems to be a couple of different lenses you guys used, brands of lenses.
Yeah.
Was the choice there a mixture of artistic and logistical? Because you've got different rigs, you need different weights, and was it that same philosophy there, or
yeah.
Was it okay?
Yes. So aesthetically, the lens was also something I inherited. But Greg and Gareth, in their design of the film, wanted the film to look like a science fiction film from the 1970s, wanted to evoke that film language of Close Encounters, Alien, Blade Runner, etc. So they were looking for, again, it was sort of like the Sony FX3. It was a search. And the search was this very narrow, specific band. Like, what is the smallest, lightest, vintage, anamorphic lens that we can find? And the answer was the Koa PS Technic Rehouse Koa 75mm, and the focal length was it's just the best focal length. That's an aesthetic choice, but we did shoot on a single focal length, so 95% of the movie is shot on the 75mm Koa. And we also had a prototype Atlas Mercury, which are even smaller and lighter. That we had a 42mm. That was the first one they made. So that covered our slightly wider range when the 75 was just a little too tight and we couldn't back up far enough. And that was it. It was those two lenses. But it was almost entirely on the 75.
Did you have eight of those? Was it hard to
match the vintage? Yeah, we had three of them. So we had to kind of swap them between the different rigs and kind of play a little guesswork, like what's the next rig we're going to be on, and play like musical chairs a little bit with the lenses. But if we could have more, we would, but those are kind of expensive lenses, so that we couldn't get that many. There aren't that many also, but we got as many as we could. They weren't perfectly matched, but again, the benefits of a film of this size, we had on-set dailies. So our dailies, techs and photochem and our colorist, all these people have been on board the project for months before we even start shooting. So we already knew what the differences between the lenses were, and we knew what slight adjustment you had to make in the dailies color grade in order to match. So as shots would come in, they could see which of the three lenses it was shot on. And depending on that, they could make whatever like slight color adjustment to match them. And so the dailies all look the same. But yeah, again, that's the benefit of having the extra support. On a smaller scale, you're not going to have all that stuff. So you have to be a little bit more clever with getting lenses that are matched. But yeah.
I have a question to Oren also. You approached the color stuff right now. Did you guys use any 3D LUT or did you use like few of them maybe? It was easy after those 4 months or you just used what you had in the camera?
Yeah, we created a custom LUT for the film with our colorist, Dave Cole at Photochem. And that was based on one of the other advantages of the FX3 was because we bought them. We had the camera, this is something I've never experienced before. We had the camera and the lens that we were gonna film the movie on all through prep for 4 months, which usually you don't have. Like if you go through a rental house, you're not gonna get access to your camera package until a week before the film at best. And maybe you get one day of, or a couple days of test shoots before that. But we had the camera for months. And so in addition to figuring out the rig and all that stuff, we took it with us everywhere on all of our location scouts and our tech scouts. So we came back from, we had like a kind of winter break after a few months of prep and then before we went back to finish prep and start filming. And we came back to Photochem in Los Angeles with a reel. We cut a reel of footage from the scouts. So we had a ton of footage with our camera, lens, combo, shot on location where we were going to go back and film. And based on that, we were able to build our LUT pretty well because we shot in all these varied filming locations that matched what we were going to do on set. We lit them. We got it as close as we could. And it was also helpful for us for scouting because we were able to actually start finding shots and finding frames and not just guessing with Artemis. Like we were actually using the camera with the lens. So yeah, we had a custom LUT. We used one LUT. Like a film stock, just pick your stock and LUT and stick with it. Just easier. And yeah, that carried through our dailies and it carried through our final grade. We did tweak it along the way a little bit, but it was pretty consistent. And it's a film emulation LUT. It's a 5203 film stock emulation LUT. But it's not the internal, the whatever comes with the FX. I don't even know what's in there. We never looked at it. Sorry.
Can I? It's me again, for Peter again. As a DAT, water-like, have you noticed any like more specific differences between XOC and XT, ST and LT? Can you talk a little bit more about that?
No major differences. The projects I've been involved on with Venice, where I've obviously got the option of changing off LT, it's usually because visual effects just want to make everything safe, so they want to go to the best that they can get. But then I've spoken to visual effects supervisors who say, well, if we have to go to LT for a frame rate issue, because we want to go fast as possible, then it's never a problem. So that's probably the best way. Like I've never really seen any major differences. And I've done, my very first project, in fact, was on Venice, and it was on a little TV drama, just the DP wanted to try it out, and on the original Venice, that was. And, production said to us, we don't even need 4K, this is a HD finish, so why are we shooting 8K? And I said, well, if I shoot 4K in the AVC codec, which is not RAW, my file size is pretty similar. Whereas if I go into LT mode on the Venice, and it was 6K, not 8K at the time, but 6K, it meant that the DP went for the DI and actually had RAW footage. So it was a big advantage there because the file size is very comparable to the best, the top end codec on the XAVC. There's a massive advantage for the grade there. Nothing too exciting that I've noticed. And as I say, it's been mainly a visual effects request because most projects I'd probably actually say, well, even ST was good enough, but it's usually XT is a visual effects request because they just want to cover themselves, make sure that they've got no problems. But It's never been an issue, really. And even when we have done any little LT for something, they've never ever come back and panicked. So, yeah.
Thank you.
I have a question for Chris real quick. This is a genuine question. How often, as a wildlife photographer, do you, does something happen that you miss and then you're just like so upset? Like how, and how do you deal with it? Especially if you only had 12 days, because that's crazy to me, because I know that these BBC documentaries shoot for like every scene sometimes gets a month, and then the documentaries are always so funny because the guys say, we waited 29 days and we never got the thing, and it rained, and then on the last day, we managed to capture the one scene that we were here for a whole month to get. So like, what happens when you miss it? How do you deal with that?
Yeah, no, you just think it never happened. No, it's like this, yes. I was speaking to Peter before. It's very funny because in the movie, you have the male lion walking with the two cubs. And actually, we were next to the male lion in the morning, but it was too late. So we said, okay, let's come back in the evening because that's when they are most active. And we went back, I think, at 3:30 in the afternoon, and he was still sleeping. And we said, okay, we will wait, actually. So the light went down, very nice light. You know, you have the sunset, and you're just looking at the light. Say, come on, move, move, move. But no, nothing. And then you have this blue light, which I love. And you say, okay, that's the time, but nothing. And then, yeah, and you take what you have. And at the end, it was very impressive because the lion was, actually, the shot, it's almost dark, pitch dark. And in the Verano, it's like the FX3, S7S3. You can go as much as you want in ISO. And when you're looking at the screen and you're looking by your eyes, you know, the camera can see much better than you. And also, what's amazing, you can see colors that you're not about to see. And that's something very strange in your mind. You say, okay, that's colorful, but me, I can see only pitch dark. Yeah, so you miss shots, of course, but I think that's also the game of doing wildlife. You need, like I say, it's when you're out 8 hours, it's 8 hours of working. And as soon as, you know, you try to do something, we were filming also. It's, you know, it's also funny because when I say when you're doing something, everything happened. And we are looking for a fish eagle to fly. We are filming in Botswana. And we really want this fish eagle to fly. So we spent, I think it was on the branch on the tree, and we spent, I think, 1 hour waiting. It doesn't move. And I talked to the guy, I said, okay, let's take a coffee, come on. And as soon as I bring my cup, the fish eagle flew away. Yeah, and that's also why I think the pre-recording can be useful. That's something we didn't talk about it, but the pre-recording in wildlife, it's just, you know, a game changer. You pre-record all the time. And if something happens, you can press record, and at least you have a few seconds. It's very useful for the hunt because, you know, when cheetah hunt, lions hunt, it takes a while. People, when they're looking at the camera, they think it's going, but no, sometimes it takes 1 hour to wait for a hunt. So if you need always a recording, you know, it takes too much data. So having the pre-recording, yeah, it's...
I think I would go insane. I'm amazed that you guys do it. I really am.
Oh, hello. I have a question for the Peter. Here. What about the shot front of the pilot? Yes. You put camera static on the plane.
Yeah.
And the second question, Burano have a gyro technology, and do you use it?
So all the shots where the camera is mounted onto the aircraft was on the Rialto. So for example, that shot is the Rialto pushed as far back in a very small canopy with a little Cook SP3, one of the prototype lenses. And you can actually see in that shot, there's actually quite a lot of vibration. Because it's rigid, everything on that aircraft is rigid. It's rigidly mounted. It has to be. You know, there's no vibration isolators either. You know, it's pretty solid. And obviously, we don't have a vibration. There's no stabilization in the sensor on the Rialto compared to the Burano. The Burano, the ground shots, stabilization was on, which is actually quite nice. There's a little shot where he's sitting in the car on the rear vision mirror, and that was actually handheld. And like the car rig shot, you know, the mount where it's at the wheel level. You know, those are the things that, you know, even that one is rigid. You know, there's no isolation on that. So, you know, it's sort of coped quite well with that. But yeah, so even James is a little bit worried. There's a few little shots like that where with the vibration, and he's like, oh, that's a bit weird because it's a bit vibrating. And it's like, actually, it's quite real because, you know, that aircraft, you know, if you're actually there, the whole thing would be just literally just doing that. So it's quite a nice little shot. And that, you know, like even later on, there's one of the last shots in the sunset with some little droplets on the lens. That's actually because the helicopter, when they keep on going behind, when the smoke was running, that's actually oil. So it was actually landing onto the housing. So they actually had to do a little landing at one point to actually clean it off, but that was still some drops left on it. But, you know, like I said, it actually looks real. It doesn't look like a volume. You know, so it was, you know, even those little vibration things, you know, because I think people would add that. But, you know, that was actually, yeah, straight out of the box, you know.
So. Okay, Burano have gyro stabilization, can save the gyro data in with the movie?
Gyro. I'm not sure if gyros. It saves it, but yeah, that might be a good little feature to put in.
We have you some people who want to answer gyro stabilization
yeah,
in the Burano.
FX3 have gyro. It's the software Catalyst. The software.
Yes. I'm getting a yes from the people who know.
I just have a little question here about for Oren.
Where is it? Yeah.
Yeah. Well, thank you for the presentation. Obviously, it's very inspiring, especially for all of us FX3 owners, just missing the couple of millions, I guess. This feature that could have been easily shot on pretty much any camera, what do you think, if you had to guess, how would the production have been different had the FX3 not been in existence, and production-wise, and what positives and negatives also?
Yeah, it's a good question. I don't know if I thought about that. Like, what other camera would they have used? I have no idea. The thing is the bigger camera systems are just slower on set. And so it's like it's a death of 1,000 cuts. You know, you lose 30 minutes here, 30 minutes there, moving a larger camera rig, dealing with all the accessories and all the additional kit and all of that. Setting up a rig, setting up a shot, everything is slower. And so it's not that you can't do it. People do. People make movies at that size with more robust camera rigs all the time. But we shot 4 hours of raw footage every day, which is a crazy ratio for single camera. Narrative, usually you get an hour and a half, maybe 2 hours, you probably know more. And that 4 hours, at the end of the day, everything that's in the movie is like the best 2 minutes of those 4 hours every day. Like the absolute best take, the best shot, the best pass, the best camera move, the best light, the best everything. And that process, we called it sifting for gold. We were like, most of the footage in this movie looks like crap, but you won't see it because that's the footage that was on the cutting room floor because we blew a take or the light wasn't right or the actors didn't land perfectly. The precision of that you see in the movie is a result of that process of iterating and iterating and iterating and constantly shooting and doing the move over and over and over again until the timing is just right and perfect, and you get that perfect moment. You get that moment of spontaneity, that like little wink or that little glint in the eye or just something accidental that happens that elevates something into something real and transcendent. That's what that let us do. That's what shooting in this style let us get. And I think that without that, we would have shot less. We probably would have had, the footage wouldn't have been as good. We would have needed more days and more money. And so that was the result. It's like we were able to make a $200 million movie for $80 million. And even that, like a lot of that went to COVID. Gareth's out there saying he's right. Like we could have made it for less, probably should have. But there's production costs that were associated with making a movie in 2021, 2022 that were unavoidable. But that's what it gave us, that a larger camera system wouldn't. So it's hard to say exactly, but I don't know. One day someone will do it. Someone should try it with a different camera and see what happens. One can hope.
Is there quite a good one more?
Just have the question about did you actually shoot a lot of the stuff on XAVC?
Was that for me?
Yeah, sorry, Orin. Yeah, oh, sorry.
No, we shot in ProRes RAW on the Atomos Ninja recorder. So we didn't use the internal codec on the FX3.
Okay, even on the gimbals and
yeah, always with the Ninja recorder.
Okay,
the internal codec just wasn't robust enough for visual effects. It's perfectly great. It's a great I've shot it since, but it's for a film like this and the needs, the visual effects needs and the color grading. We needed RAW. We needed the ProRes RAW. But we use the Ninja recorder as a monitor. So you know you're gonna put a monitor on the gimbal anyway. You might as well use it as a recorder. Two birds, one stone. But yeah, there's no XAVC in the movie as far as I know. It's RAW. And on the FX9, we use the RAW recorder as well.
Thank you.
Yeah, if I might. Oren, one question. You shot such high ISOs. How did you deal with the noise? Or was there any noise?
It's not as noisy as you think. It's pretty clean. We were shocked. That was one of the biggest shocks of the whole thing. We were like, there's something going on internally in the camera, because it's actually not, I don't know much about it, but because I'm not a tech savvy person. It's funny, I'm on a panel talking about technology and I'm like, I don't know any of this stuff. But there's some internal process in the camera, from my understanding, that the high ISO, the 12,800 base, is actually like doing some denoise in the camera.
And after talking to Greg, we're trying to figure out what that exactly is, because yeah, he likes it so much.
I know, we love the look of it. Yes. There is a little bit of noise, but it's like filmic. We exactly. Just like that we liked it.
Exactly.
But in the final movie, we actually did a lot of more. We did more denoise in the grade, and then added film grain back in. So there's a lot of manipulation of the noise floor and the grain levels to get that final look. But just to start with, yeah, ISO 12,800, especially in RAW, was shockingly clean. And every other ISO was horrible. Yep. Like 12,000, unused, so grainy. 12,800, clean as a whistle. And then 16,000, horrible. So
it's one of those things you have to see to believe. Once you see, you're like, oh, okay.
There's something going on. There's Sony people here that know what it is. So find them and they'll be able to tell you. I can't help beyond that.
Thank you.
For Oren, I'm just wondering, because you mentioned the director was the one operating the camera, like how was that for you? Like, is that how you work usually, or is it annoying you at some point?
Yeah, no, it's not usually how I work. Directors usually don't want anything to do with the camera or the lenses or the lighting or anything. They just want to be in their happy actor place and have everybody leave them alone. But Gareth isn't like that. He's a hands-on director, not just with camera. He's designing costumes, silhouettes. He's working on visual effects. He was doing, on the way to set, there's some like fake corporations in the movie, just little things like details to fill out the world, like on billboards and stuff. And these are little details that fall through the cracks because the art team is so busy. And there is one person who is like the graphic designer, but their hands are full. So Gareth is like on the way to set on his laptop designing logos, like company logos, because he used to be a graphic designer and a DP and a visual effects artist. So that's just the kind of director he is. And that is, if not unique, at the very least, extremely rare, but very wonderful to be able to work with that. Yeah, the operator thing, it would be annoying if he wasn't a good operator. But he's a good operator. He has really good taste, and he has a good eye. He can find light. He knows like, you know, if you're framing this up, this is going to be flat and look terrible. Yeah. This is going to look great. That intuitive thing, he already knows. You don't have to tell him. You don't have to guide him. He understands it intuitively. So yeah, he's a good operator. His headroom could use some work, but we worked on that during the shoot. But. Yeah, it was for me. It was great, because I didn't have to sweat. I didn't have to physically hold the camera rig. I mean, it was 100 degrees Fahrenheit. What is that? It's like 42 degrees Celsius, and 100% humidity in Thailand. So, you know, he's out there sweating, like dripping sweat on the actors. because he's, you know, like getting a shot like above them and just like dripping sweat into their face. But so I'm like, I'm just glad that wasn't me. So I
dripping or dripped on.
Exactly. Well, maybe, yeah, maybe dripped on. No, but I just got to stand by the monitor and I was still sweating, but I was stationary. I wasn't moving around too much. So it was good.
Hey, Oren. Is any other cameras have been tested during the pre-production program?
I don't know. Oh. I don't know. They wouldn't have told you.
They wouldn't have told me.
When they came to
they just came to me and were very happy, yeah.
I don't know. I don't think so. Like I said, the proof of concept was shot on the Nikon DSLR. Right. So I think they probably started from that space. But I think all those cameras were eliminated without even testing, like, because it's just they don't have robust enough raw capabilities and stuff like that. So it just wasn't.
And the body itself, which lent itself well to being to be built up and all those things that you guys did. So it was a big part of it.
Because keeping in mind the FX3 is the cinema right. Inverse mirror version of the A7.
Right. And so, the overheating and all the other things that we did in that camera to make it. Really
to make it appropriate for cinema.
100 or something degrees.
Exactly. So in theory, you know, like even the A7, you could say, well, it's the same sensor, it's the same thing. That would not have been considered because it's not designed to be used for video. You can switch it over to video and shoot on it. Many people have, and it looks great. It looks fine. You can do a lot of stuff with that camera. But it wasn't quite enough to the rigor. So we needed the cinema body and the heat control. We never had heat issues somehow. It's crazy. In Thailand, you would think these cameras would be falling, but it was great.
Oh, I got a microphone, sorry. just a question for Oren. Did you have a hard time finding like a lighting department and a gaffer who was like intuitively into your guerrilla style filmmaking and like smart lighting approach?
Greg found our gaffer, so I have no idea if it was a hard time. I don't think so, because from my experience, my perspective, it was like, here's the gaffer, and he was great. So so whatever process Greg went through to search for gaffers, I don't think it was that rigorous, though, to be honest, because again, it was like we were looking for somebody so specific that I think there was only one person in Thailand that could have done it. So we wanted somebody
who... That's the hard part, no?
His name's Pitai... Smith, I think is how you pronounce it. I feel bad that I always mispronounce his last name. But he's amazing. He's actually a DP. So he was a local. He's a Thai DP. Educated in the U.S. Speaks fluent English. He's the son of like the most venerated, greatest gaffer in Thailand history, who's gaffed like Oliver Stone movies. That shot there, El Salvador and Platoon, and like he's been gaffing since the 70s, 80s on big studio films that have been shooting in Thailand. So Pitai's his son, and so he speaks fluent English, is a DP, so he thinks kind of scrappy out of the box. He's not like, I'm a gaffer and I'm really rigid, but he took a gap year to focus on electric work on bigger shoots. So he just came from Killers of the Flower Moon. He was on the electric team. He was a spark for 7 months in Oklahoma. And then he came onto our project as a gaffer. He was just in this adventurous mode of like, I'm gonna broaden my horizons as a DP to like learn from all these. Ian Kincaid was the gaffer on Killers of the Flower Moon. He's a legendary gaffer. And he and their fathers, his father knows Ian. So we wanted someone who spoke English, fluent English, because it would have been very difficult for me and Gareth because we're annoying Westerners who don't learn the local language well enough to communicate. But so he was just the perfect person. And I think because he's a DP, he like got what we were doing, and he didn't have the trepidation over like, what are you doing? Yeah. He was on board.
Okay, and just a small second question. I know you didn't operate for the most part, but I imagine with the FX3 on like a handheld rig, like, some cinematographers might say they prefer a heavier camera because it's smoother to operate. You get like a more like smoother feeling in it.
We would shoot 30 to 40 minute takes, so a heavier camera would have literally killed Gareth. I think he would have died. So that was a bit, I mean, it was a factor. That was the lens, the camera body. That was why we needed it to be lightweight, because we wanted to use the RS2 gimbal because it was small and lightweight. And there's a 5-pound limit on the RS2 gimbal, so it really limits what you can put on it. But anything heavier would have been horrible. We needed the weight to be able to operate for 40 minutes. Even holding this for 10 minutes like that hurts. So, you know, and this weighs nothing. So, yeah, heavy camera. If you're shooting a 60-second take, I can see an argument for that. But that's not how we rolled.
I have a question for you as well. How did your planning differ from like a more conventional production with knowing that you would have that much time to shoot? Did it go into more shots or did it go into like more perfection in terms of like what takes you were gonna like end up using?
Probably both. It did allow for a lot of time on set in each location. And it allowed us to shoot, we shot in 80 locations just in Thailand. So it was still a lot of, I mean, we would usually have 1 or 2 days at a location. So it's still tight. Like it still felt like we didn't have enough time. But we did, because usually on a 20-day indie film, you know, you have to shoot 4 scenes a day or more. And we would show up at a location and we could shoot one scene for a whole day or over 2 days. So it gave us more time to explore, I think, which resulted in both. We got more shots, but also we got more time to iterate shots. So it was a little bit of both.
And were there still time issues or?
Oh, horrible. we still, like I said, I mean, it felt like we could have shot twice the length of time. Like it still didn't feel like enough time. We were always rushing, always. Apparently that never changes. I didn't realize because I had done indie films before this, and you have 20 days, and you feel like you don't have any time because you don't. And then you go here, and you have 90 days, and you're like, oh, we still don't have time. How does that work? How does that math? That doesn't make sense. The scripts are the same length. I don't understand. But you never have enough time, as I found out. It's like you always feel like you want and need more time. And also we were shooting kind of similar to the wildlife photography, like you want to shoot a very naturalistic style. So dawn, dusk, blue hour, and closer to the equator, you know, that window is much shorter. It's not blue hour, it's blue 15 minutes. That's what they said in Thailand. That's what the gaffer said. He's like, it's blue 15 minutes. Just remember that. And it was. So there's never enough time. You're always, always rushing.
Speaking of time, we are right up against it. I think we'll take one last question.
Yeah, hello. I have a question because you said that you used mostly the second bias ISO. And my question is if you were not fighting with practical lights, they were too bright and overexposing.
Well, we would replace a lot of the practicals with our own lights. So we had them all on dimmers on an iPad. So we could control the brightness if we ever ran into that issue. But also, honestly, no. I don't know how you guys found the Burano, but at least on the FX3 for some reason, I mean, it was our LUT, really. I mean, it was our color grade, but we were able to round off the shoulder in the highlight. So even when a light was overexposed, it's the roll off was smooth because of how we processed the footage in the color grade, and I think the RAW helped, the ProRes RAW. It just gave us a lot of extra. I mean, the ProRes RAW is 15 stops of a dynamic range. It's equivalent to Alexa or Venice or whatever. So you're not compromising on dynamic range. If you're going to blow out a highlight on a Venice, you're going to blow it out on the FX3. But I think our color grade, we were able to just smooth that out. So there are blown out highlights, but they don't have that look. They don't have that garish look because we would pull the highlights down and then roll off the shoulder. So it was a smooth transition. We gave them a little bloom, very subtle bloom too, which is kind of a filmic thing, like film halation. So that also helps. It just softens it a little bit. So you don't notice when they're blown out.
And what was your biggest lamp on the set? Light? The biggest light on the set?
Aperture 1200D. Okay. Yeah. Well, we day played in 18K. It was on one day, so we didn't break the rules too much, our own imposed rules. I mean, there's nobody forced us to shoot with small lights, but except ourselves. But yeah, we did have an 18K on one day, and that was in Thailand. In London, on Pinewood, we had every light you can think of. It was actually kind of surreal to come from this kind of small, scrappy location shoot and then go to stage, and you have, you know, carts full of cream source vortexes and big lights and big HMIs and 18Ks and everything you could possibly want and movers. So it was great, but it was weird. So it was like, we don't need all this stuff. What is this all doing here?
Well, thank you very much, guys. That was a lot of fun. I can't believe it was 2 hours.